Okay, let's now take a look at the idea of sample spaces as they relate to probabilities. Now, a sample space is a set of all possible outcomes in an experiment. If I were to take a single coin and flip it, what could happen? I could get a head or a tail. So my sample space would consist of a head and a tail. That's all that can happen. That's everything that could happen, every possible outcome. A simple sample space, oops, didn't want that one. Let me grab this. Sorry about that. There we go. A simple sample space is a sample space where each outcome is equally likely, such as tossing a single coin. The probability of a head is the same as the probability of a tail, assuming, and the assumption is kind of important here, assuming that the coin is fair to begin with. Now, a list of the sample space for tossing two coins, as in the simulation that we did in the calculator earlier, we would say S, I don't want that color, there we go. We say S equals, we use set notation, head, tail. That's it, that's the sample space. Now the notation N of S is used to indicate the number of elements in the sample space. In this particular sample space, there's one element, there's one of them, there's a second one, there's two. So in this particular example, N of S equals 2. Now this is function notation, N of S. It's the number of elements in the sample space. It is not algebraic notation. It's not N times S. This is not a multiplication. Keep that in mind because that's a very, very common mistake. We start using this notation in equations, then all of a sudden people start canceling out N's when you can't. There's no N here to cancel out. This is N of S. They stay together. It's function notation, the number of elements in the sample space. Now, any subset or combination of a sample space is what we refer to as being an event. So an event is any subset, any combination of a sample space. Now, let's consider tossing three coins, and I want to let the event A be the observed two heads. I want to list the sample space and then actually find the probability of A. Now, to list the sample space, I'm going to suggest that you use a probability tree. It makes it a little bit easier to keep track of things. And if you haven't seen one, this is where we do. I'm going to start off here, and I'm going to branch off. This first branch represents the first time I toss a coin. There's three coins there, so I have one coin, I toss it. What do I get? I could get a head, or I could get a tail. Now, I'm going to branch again. The second branch is representative of tossing a second coin. Well, if I got a head the first time, when I toss a coin a second time, I could get a head or a tail. If I had a tail the first time, the second coin, I could also get a head or a tail. This would actually be the sample space for tossing two coins. If I branch off a little bit further, if I had head on the first coin, head on the second coin, I could get a head on the third coin or a tail on a third coin. Likewise, continuing the branching, now this represents everything that can happen if I were to toss three coins. Now, I'm going to go through here. I have a head, head, head. I'm just literally following along this path. Oops, I don't like that one. Sorry. I missed. There we go. I'm following along this path. Now I'm going to follow along this path. And when I do, I get head, head, tail. Now if I follow along this path, I get head, tail, head, and so forth. Following along every path will give me every possible combination. Very quickly, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 outcomes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Good, I got them all. Now, if I think in terms of the number of heads, I could get 0 heads, 1 head, 2 heads, or 3 heads. Because remember, the question was, what's the probability of getting 2 heads? So I need to organize the information so I can actually answer that question. Well, zero heads is the same as all tails. There it is. There's only one. Whoops. I wrote that wrong. I knew it was down there, but I actually wrote it wrong. This last one is tails. So there's only one way that can happen. One head. Well, that has three. That has two. That has two. That has one. There's one of them. There's two of them. There's three of them. So there's three different ways that I could get one head. Two heads. Well, there's one, two, three. There's three ways I can get two heads. Three heads, there's only one. If I add this up, it better be eight. Three, six, seven, eight. Good, it adds up to eight. So this is the number of ways that every possible event could happen. If I take each of these and divide it, that will give me the probability. So the probability of A, where A is, I observe two heads, is the number of ways that A can happen. Well, if I look over here, A, there's two heads, can happen three ways. So this is three, divided by N of S. What's N of S in this case? Eight. There's eight elements in my sample space. Now notice, I did not do anything silly like trying to cancel out the N's. That's, like I said earlier, that is not multiplication. It's function notation. It is not multiplication. This would be a very silly sort of a thing to do. So the probability of getting exactly two heads when I toss three coins is 3/8. Now this is theoretical. See, I derived this mathematically. I didn't actually take three coins and simulate it to see what happened. I actually did it. Okay, let's see here. Consider actually tossing a coin 10 times. Go ahead and pause the video for just a minute. Grab a coin, any old coin, and do it. Record the results. And a smart way to record the results may be in terms of ones and zeros. Now, I'm asking here for the probability of a head. Okay, so I've got a single coin, so probability of a head. So every time I toss a coin, if I get a head, I'm going to write down a 1. If I get a tail, I'm going to write down a 0. The reason I did that is because if I add up all those numbers, whatever it adds up to, that's the number of heads. So go ahead and do that and pause the presentation, do it, then come on back when you're done. Now, I just happened to have done this before I started today, and what I ended up with when I tossed a quarter 10 times is I actually ended up with N of H equaling 6. There were six times out of 10, I saw a head. That means 4 times out of 10, I saw a tail. And N is 10. Now, notice once again, I'm not canceling out N's. This is not algebraic. It's not N times H. Okay? That's the number of heads. There were 6. The number of times N, the number of times I did it, that is 10. So that probability is 6 out of 10. Now, notice that this was an empirical probability. I actually did it. I really flipped a coin a little while ago, and this is what actually happened. Over here, on this three-coin situation, this was theoretical. It's not empirical. This is, in theory, what should happen. Okay, now, something about probabilities, some properties of probability that you really need to make sure you have a firm grasp on. Number one, probabilities always reside on 0, 1. Okay, what that means is that 0 is the absolute smallest any probability can be, and that 1 is the absolute largest that any probability can be. There's an infinite number of possibilities between those, but those are, in fact, the smallest and biggest. Now, if a probability of 0, if you have a probability of 0, that simply means whatever event you're looking at never happens. As an example, toss three coins, what's the probability to see four heads? That's impossible, it never happens. What if I told you I had a coin, a single coin, and the probability that I flip it and I get a head is 0, and I'm not lying to you, it's accurate, it's actually accurate. What does that mean? Probability of getting a head is 0. What does that tell you about that coin? It's a two-tailed coin. Right? Every time I flip it, it's going to be a tail. So this probability of a head will be 0. Likewise, if 1 happens, what that's saying is that it always happens. Okay, so if it always happens, like in my two-tailed coin situation, the probability of tails will always be 1. If it always happens, the probability is 1. Having a probability greater than 1 or less than 0 is both mathematically impossible and it has no meaning. Because 1 says it always happens. What does it mean to have a probability bigger than 1? Does that mean you're not kidding? You're serious? It really always happens? No. You see, it loses meaning right away. And likewise, a negative probability is absolutely impossible. Now, mathematically, it's impossible to have a probability smaller than 0 or greater than 1. Well, why is that true? Why is it that it is mathematically impossible for that to happen? Well, if we think of probabilities as the number of ways the event can happen, say event A, divided by the number in the sample space. Well, if A never ever happens, then that would be 0 over whatever possibilities, number of possibilities in the sample space. That's 0. You can't have something happen in a negative amount of time. The number of elements in the sample space will always be positive. 0 is 0. So 0 over a positive number is still 0. It's impossible to get negative. Likewise, again, suppose that the event A always happens. Well, if it always happens, then every element in the sample space is event A. It qualifies as event A. So in that case, the number of ways N can happen is actually the exact same thing as the number in the sample space. So I have the number in the sample space divided by the number in the sample space. Well, that's 1. I can have any value that I want, or any. There's an infinite number of possibilities between 0 and 1, but it's mathematically impossible to be bigger than 1 or less than 0 when we're talking about probabilities. Now, this is extremely important for my students. Pay attention, specifically that your students are taking the course from me. If you report a probability greater than 1 or less than 0, and let's just pretend there's 5 points possible on this particular question, I'm going to take away 6, 7 if I'm in a bad mood. Okay? It's impossible to do. So if you do it, my thinking is if you can do something possible, so can I. Okay? What I'm trying to drive home is the basic idea of probabilities is extremely important in this course. Where we're heading with probabilities, we're going to be using them a great deal. It's extremely important to comprehend what these probabilities actually mean. So if you report a probability bigger than 1, it's not possible to do. It is impossible. If you do that, I'll take away more points that are possible. Now, that's just me and my students. If you're not taking the course from me, you may want to check the professor and see what his or her attitude is toward that.